Good morning, everyone. Welcome back to Doctor Talks. Today, we will be dealing with bronchial asthma. First, we'll start with the prevalence of bronchial asthma. As we all know, bronchial asthma is a disease that is more commonly seen in the developed countries. It is also seen in developing countries, but especially the more affordable developed countries have gotten higher incidence of bronchial asthma. And even in, it has got two bimodal peaks, one in the childhood and the second one is the adulthood. In the children, it is seen up to 15% of the children, it has got a peak prevalence of 3 years of age. In the children, it is more common in boys than girls. In the adults, however, there is no sex difference. It is equally seen in both men and women. The important reason why it is seen in developed countries and in an affordable population is that, or urban population is that, we'll define it by the help of hygiene hypothesis. So what is hygiene hypothesis? When a baby is born, it will have a TH2 overactivity. At birth, there will be TH2 overactivity. If the baby is exposed to constant allergens, the house dust mites, pollens in their younger age group, if their baby is allowed to play in all the dirt and things, the baby will be constantly exposed to all these allergens, and the TH2 will be converted to TH1 response. This will be persistent. This is what happens in a rural setup, in a baby that is brought up in a rural setup. Whereas in a baby that is brought up in an urban setup, where there is more, there is less exposure to all these usual dust particles are playing in the dirt, they won't be doing all those things. They will have a persistent TH2 response. This increases the risk of bronchial asthma. This hygiene hypothesis also holds good for type 1 diabetes mellitus and a lot of other conditions. First, we have to understand what is called as airway hyperresponsiveness. What is this airway hyperresponsiveness? Well, usually a normal bronchi will not respond to certain triggers, say dust or a pollen or a house or the cat's hair or fur. So this normally we have just minimal response or no response. Whereas a bronchial asthma patient, when they are exposed to these common allergens, there is severe bronchoconstriction and the development of symptoms like breathlessness, wheeze. The common allergens can produce excessive immune response. This is called as airway hyperresponsiveness. This airway hyperresponsiveness is basically because of airway inflammation. Airway inflammation, especially by eosinophils and mast cells, which we will be dealing with later. Reversibility. This is the second most important finding of a bronchial asthma. A bronchial asthma, the bronchospasm is usually reversible. Unlike COPD, where it is a permanent condition, bronchial asthma is a reversible condition. We identify this reversibility by giving 15 minutes of nebulization with a salbutamol. 15 minutes of nebulization with a salbutamol. Or this will increase the FEV1 by more than 12% increase in FEV1 or 200 ml increase in FEV1. So what does it mean? It means that this condition can reverse. The FEV1, which is usually decrease in bronchial asthma patient, it will be reversed by administering bronchial asthma. So it is a reversible condition. That is the point. The other point you have to think of, there is variable airflow limitations. The airflow limitations can vary between day and night. In night, usually they will have increased symptoms like breathlessness and runs, but morning it won't be of much symptoms. So it has got a variable, and also with treatment also it will have variable responsiveness. Now, what are the risk factors for bronchial asthma? First, most important risk factor, that is the atopy. Atopy, what is atopy? Atopy means individuals who are at high risk of developing recurrent allergic rhinitis. They have frequent cough, sneezing, those findings, and finding of allergic dermatitis. These patients will have an increase in IgE levels in their blood. These patients can also develop increased incidence of bronchial asthma. Almost 80% of the bronchial asthma patients are found to be atopic, that is especially prevalent in the urban populations. This atopy is characterized by increased levels of IgE level in the serum. Now, genetics. Genetics by the two important genes. The two is mainly the 5q polymorphism as well as patients can, this 5q polymorphism, what does it do means there will be Th2 activation. As I said earlier, the Th2 activation will produce more of interleukin 4, interleukin 5, interleukin 13, interleukin 9. All these interleukins can increase the risk of developing bronchial asthma. The patient can have other gene mutations, but this way you can say the identical twins have got a higher incidence of bronchial asthma between them. That is because of these genetic mutations. Then epigenetic modulations. Epigenetic modulations, because say if in a mother's fetus can develop bronchial asthma based on mother's environmental exposure. If a mother is exposed to say cigarette smoking or a passive smoking or a atmospheric pollution, they, all these can adversely affect the DNA methylation and histone modification. So that will refer to defective DNA formation and make it more prone for formation of bronchial asthma. Then infections. The common infections like a rhinovirus or a respiratory syncytial virus or a chlamydia infection or a mycoplasma infections. All these infection in childhood can increase the development of bronchial asthma in later period of life. And again, the hygiene hypothesis which we discussed earlier can also be put as a risk factor for infections. Then diet. Diet, there can be deficiency of vitamin A, vitamin C, vitamin D, selenium and magnesium. All this deficiency of all these essential vitamins with excess consumption of sodium chloride and excess consumption of omega-6 polyunsaturated fatty acids. There will be deficiency of omega-3 polyunsaturated fatty acids. So this is the dietary risk factors. Then air pollution. The air pollution with the help of, usual air pollutants are the sulfur dioxide, paint fumes. The patient can have diesel particulates, passive smoking, especially if you have women, the indoor air pollution, the cooking gas, the fumes, cooking fumes, all this thing can worsen the increased risk of bronchial asthma. The again, atopy means they will have increased exposure to allergens. The common allergens are the dermatophagoids. The dermatophagoids, what are the dermatophagoids? The common house pollen, grass pollen, something called cat hair, dog's hair, any household cockroaches, any household dust can trigger this inflammation. Then other conditions like obesity. Obesity increases the risk of bronchial asthma. Both incidence of bronchial asthma is also increased, and also the difficulty in, there is also more difficult, obese patients are more difficult to treat. These are the findings. And the other risk factors, the rare risk factors are a low birth weight, preterm babies, babies with decreased duration of breastfeeding, mothers whose weight is very low. All these factors can also increase the risk of bronchial asthma. And the last one will be the occupation. Occupational asthma is a unique finding because this patient will have finding of bronchial asthma right through the week. The weekends will be asymptomatic. Weekdays will be symptomatic. They will have breathlessness, cough, fever. What are the workers who develop bronchial asthma? Bakers. Bakers, because they are exposed to the wheat mold. The wheat molds, the exposure, because bakers are more prone to develop. The other occupations includes cleaners. Because of the constant exposure to the cleaning fluid, they can also have this thing. And animal husbandry, animal workers. They also are at risk of developing bronchial asthma. Now, these are the risk factors we have discussed. Now, what are the triggers? So, what is a trigger? A trigger means in some genetically predisposed patient who has got this environmental modification, the presence of these triggers can produce an acute bronchospasm because of mast cell destabilization, and they can develop bronchial asthma. What are the important triggers? Previously, it was thought you have to avoid all these triggers, but nowadays there has been impetus, means it is not just avoiding the triggers. The patient is having trigger-induced bronchial asthma, you should go for more of a controller medications. So what are the triggers? First, the virus, especially that are widespread syncytial virus, rhinovirus, coronavirus, all these things, usual virus. Then second, the allergens. Again, the dermatophagoids, house dust mite, cockroaches, pollens, something. Allergens, something called as thunderstorm asthma. Usually pollens can produce only allergic rhinitis. During thunderstorms, there will be a widespread discharge of the pollens, and they got very severe bronchial attack of a bronchial asthma, that is called as a thunderstorm asthma. Then third group will be the drugs. What are the drugs which can cause bronchial asthma? The beta blockers, especially non-selective beta blockers, are more prone to develop bronchial asthma, and patients with aspirin-sensitive asthma. This aspirin-sensitive asthma is a unique phenotype, because these patients with aspirin-sensitive asthma, they have nasal polyp, they have got perineal rhinitis, they can develop severe bronchial asthma. Usually, they don't have the other phenotypic findings of asthma, but only aspirin allergens. Not only aspirin allergy, any COX inhibitors in this patient can develop this adverse reactions. Then the food particles, food preservatives, namely metabisulfite and tartrazine. Sodium metabisulfate can be used as a food preservative. It can metabolize in the stomach to produce sulfur dioxide that can worsen bronchial asthma. Tartrazine is a coloring agent added to the food, is yellow colored. It also causes worsening of bronchial asthma. And other than hormonal hormones, there will be premenopausal worsening of bronchial asthma. That is because of a low progesterone levels. And any patient with refractory asthma, they have to go for the thyroid examination, because both hypothyroidism and hypothyroidism both of them can cause worsening of bronchial asthma. The other risk factors of bronchial asthma include stress. Stress can produce exacerbation of bronchial asthma, and exercise induced asthma. What is exercise induced asthma? When you exercise, there will be dehydration of the bronchiolar lumen. This dehydration will increase the osmolarity of the lining fluid, that will activate the mast cells. Your activation of mast cells will produce degranulation. Degranulation, release of histamine, serotonin, leukotrienes will cause an acute episode of bronchial asthma. It's usually after you stop the exercise, and it can extend up to a period of 30 minutes. This exercise-induced asthma can be prevented by prior administration of a beta block of a beta agonist, short-acting beta agonist, or an inhalation corticosteroid, or a long-acting beta agonist. These are the important triggers. These are the important triggers which can worsen bronchial asthma. So how does bronchial asthma occurs? So what is the pathophysiology of bronchial asthma? So first time when you are when an allergen is inhaled, there will be production of specific IgE and IgE antibodies to gain this allergen. This IgE antibodies will go and bind to the mast cell, and they will be present in the respiratory epithelium. What happens on repeated exposure, a second exposure to the similar allergen, but will result in degranulation of the mast cells and release of all the inflammatory mediators, histamine, serotonin, leukotriene, all the results. These inflammatory mediators will cause bronchospasm, will cause increase in vascular permeability, cause vasodilatation, and this can trigger an attack of bronchial asthma. This is the early phase reactions. In late phase reaction is predominant by then eosinophil infiltration into the vessel wall, and eosinophil produces a late onset bronchial, late changes of bronchial asthma are seen. So first we will be seeing with what happens, the pathology. So airways, we will see by layer to layer. First, the mucosal layer. The mucosal layer will be increased. Why does the mucosal layer increase? Because there will be increase in the mucosal blood flow, one. Then there will be increase in the mucus producing goblet cells, and there will be increased production of mucus from the epithelial cells. All these reasons will cause increase in the thickness of mucus cells, Sometimes this excess mucus can cause luminal occlusion itself. So increase mucus production. That is the first point. Second one, the airway epithelium. What happens to the airway epithelium? The airway epithelium, usually a pseudocertified ciliated columnar epithelium, there will be a disruption of airway epithelium. Because of the disruption of airway epithelium, there will be exposure of the structures underlying. The sensory nerves in the deeper layer will be activated. Activation of sensory layer 1. Second, the disruption of airway epithelium will make the underlying submucosa more prone to exposure to the bronchial allergens. Then thirdly, the epithelial derived relaxing factors will be absent, and that can also cause worsening of the bronchial asthma. This is the second. Third one is the basement membrane. The epithelial airway epithelium disrupted. Basement membrane will be thickening. So how does this basement membrane thicken? Thickening plus fibrosis. Because the basement membrane, there will be deposition of both type 3 collagen and type 5 collagen in the subepithelial layer. This will increase the thickness of the basement membrane. This is because of, predominantly because of, there is more of eosinophil in the basement membrane. This eosinophil will produce PDGF and other fibrogenic cytokines that will cause the fibrosis and increase in the thickness of the basement membrane. Then vessels. What happens to vessels? There is angiogenesis, there is production of new blood vessels within the bronchial wall, plus there will be exudation. The exudation from the post capillary venules, this exudation into the walls of the bronchi and also within the lumen of the bronchi, both of them can have exudations. Then the patient can, other finding is that airway hyper responsiveness. That is an early, is because of early hyper responsiveness because of mast cell mediated. This will produce mast cell mediated, and this can produce histamine. These are the airway findings of this thing in a bronchial asthma patients. Okay, so we found that there will be severe airway inflammation. What does this airway inflammation do? The airway inflammation is from the trachea till the later end stages of bronchi. Everywhere there will be inflammation. The airway inflammation predominantly by the eosinophils. Eosinophils will produce late phase reactions. Eosinophils responsible for late phase response. And the mast cells, that is responsible for early phase response. And the T lymphocytes, especially the Th2. This is responsible for the persistence of inflammation within the vessel wall. This asthma is not a case where there is acute inflammation and then it subsides. That is not the case. In bronchial asthma, there is full-fledged inflammation of the airways for a chronic period of time, and this will be superimposed by acute exacerbation. That acute exacerbation is where you have acute inflammation. However, you will always have some sort of chronic inflammation going on in the bronchial vessels. So Th2, this is one of the persistence of inflammation. They produce the interleukin-4, interleukin-5, interleukin-13. Everything, this is the 4 and 5, this is the responsible for eosinophil recruitment as also recruitment of lymphocytes. Then what are the other inflammations because of neutrophils? Neutrophils can also be seen, but these neutrophils are less responsive to treatment with steroids than eosinophilic inflammation. And eosinophilic inflammation has a good response to steroids, but a neutrophil inflammation has got a poor response to steroids. So the classic findings of a bronchial asthma are the Charcot-Leydig crystals, the Crushman spiral, and the Crayola bodies. These are classic pathological findings seen in a case of bronchial asthma. So clinical features, how does bronchial asthma present? The patient can present with breathlessness, cough with expectoration if there is an underlying inflammation, and infection. Usual presentation of bronchial asthma, as we all know, is be a breathlessness, sudden onset, severe breathlessness, usually of grade 3 or usually grade 3, some higher grade breathlessness with a diffuse wheezing all over the chest, with the patient can have hypoxia. This is the usual presentation of bronchial asthma. So it is important to measure daytime symptoms, the nighttime symptoms, the daytime symptoms, nighttime symptoms, and how is the activity of daily living. So based, you should measure how his daytime symptoms are, how his nighttime symptoms are, what is the how does he perform all his day-to-day activities, and how use of bronchodilators. If it is less than 2 times a week or more than 2 times a week, everything is important, because we grade based on this intermittent asthma or mild persistent, moderate persistent, severe persistent asthma. If the patient has got all the daytime symptoms plus nighttime, most of the nights are symptomatic, you have to go term as severe persistent asthma. So how do you differentiate severe persistent from asthma with severe persistent asthma versus bronchial asthma with impending respiratory failure? Bronchial asthma with impending respiratory failure, because it is, why do you differentiate both these conditions? Because you have to differentiate, because the treatment protocol is entirely different. For acute severe asthma, we manage with drugs. We give 3 doses of dual nebulization, nebulization, the sartagnin beta agonist and the inhalation corticosteroids. They are given 3 cycles over 15 minutes duration. If they are not responsive, you go for IV steroids in the form of IV hydrocortisone or IV methylprednisolone. If they are not responsive, you can go for IV aminophylline infusion or a Maxell infusion. If still responsive, you go a non-invasive ventilation. And if nothing works, then finally only we will go for mechanical intubation. However, in asthma with impending respiratory failure, we can take the patient as a prophylactic intubation can be tried. So when do you think of asthma with impending respiratory failure? The patient is silent. There is a silent chest. The patient doesn't speak. The patient is silent. If there is bradycardia, if the patient is having hypotension, if the patient is having not able to speak words, this is what is called an asthma with impending respiratory failure. Whereas in acute severe asthma, the patient will be active, he will be crying for help, he will be very severely breathlessness, he will be very active, use of axillary muscles of respiration, there will be pulses paradoxes, there will be peak expiratory variations will be significant, all these findings will be there. But if the patient is silent, you have to think as a bad prognosis and you have to go for intubation. If there is an asthma with impending respiratory failure, you can have supportive evidence with the help of an ABG. ABG will show an hypoxia with an respiratory acidosis. Then you can confirmly think it is respiratory failure, take the patient for intubation. So diagnosis. Diagnosis, first you do one pulmonary function test. Pulmonary function test, as any obstructive disease, FEV1 will be low, will be decreased. Because the bronchial asthma, as we have already seen, will be bronchospasm. Because of the bronchospasm, we cannot blow the air out. So they will have some expiratory difficulty. So an obstructive phenomenon will be found. FE1 will be decreased. Then FEV1 by FVC ratio will be decreased. The peak expiratory flow rate will be more than 20% within day. If you do a morning and night, you will have significant difference between the morning and night, it will be more than 20%. Then since there will be evidence of air trapping, there will be increase in residual volume, increase in total lung capacity. The patient can also have increase in these are the basic PFT findings. Sometimes the DLCO can be usually normal. DLCO is usually normal in the case of bronchial asthma, sometimes even increased in case of bronchial asthma. First you do a PFT, then you have to identify what is called as reversibility. What is this reversibility? Reversibility means you have to give, again, as I said earlier, after 15 minutes of nebulization with salbutamol or after 4 weeks of treatment with oral prednisolone 40 mg per day, if the patient's FEV1 increases by 12% or a 200 ml increase, then you can define it as a reversible condition. Then second one, we run airway hyperresponsiveness. Airway hyperresponsiveness by methacholine challenge test
मेथकोलिन चैलेंज टेस्ट और हिस्टामिन चैलेंज टेस्ट. इन मेथकोलिन चैलेंज टेस्ट airway hyperresponsiveness can be defined by there will be more than 20% increase in FEV1 after the methacholine challenge. For that is the this one XIS challenge can also be given or an histamine challenge can also be given. What does this mean? Giving a vasoconstrictor, there will be worsening of bronchoconstrictor function, so 20% fall in the FEV1. Then what are the other tests you can do? You can do an IgM, blood test in the form of you measured and raised IgE levels or a raised IgE to the specific antigen by the RAST test. What is this? Radiology absorption test. You can identify the specific IgE antibodies for the for some allergens. That can be measured, and that if it's raised, you can think it as bronchial asthma. Then other condition, chest X-ray. Chest X-ray is usually normal in bronchial asthma. Sometimes there can be air trapping. Or there can be evidence of pneumothorax in acute severe bronchial asthma. Or there can be evidence of underlying consolidation. Or there can be fleeting opacities. Fleeting opacities, you have to think of bronchopulmonary aspergillosis. Can do a CT thorax. CT thorax can show honeycombing. Sometimes bronchiectasis. CT usually normal. Bronchiectasis findings can be seen in a patient with a long-standing bronchial asthma. In the terminal stage can develop bronchiectasis, so CT scan can identify this bronchiectasis. The other tests includes these are the skin test. I have to go for a skin test. Skin test will be positive in extrinsic asthma, but it will be negative in intrinsic asthma. What is the intrinsic asthma? Intrinsic asthma means asthma that is present for the first time in the adult life. This intrinsic asthma has got a negative skin test. They have normal IgE levels. They are because of aspirin has hypersensitivity. That is found with some test site is seen in this intrinsic asthma, an aspirin intolerance, nasal polyp, and severe bronchial asthma. This some test site is positive, and also there is because of staphylococcal superantigen toxicity that can only produce this intrinsic asthma. Skin test will be positive in extrinsic asthma and negative in intrinsic asthma. Positive in extrinsic, negative in intrinsic. What are the other tests you can do? You can go for FeNO, fractional excretion of nitric oxide. What does this fractional excretion of nitric oxide means? Nitric oxide is increasingly released in the form air case of eosinophilic inflammation of the airway walls. When there is eosinophilic inflammation of airway walls, there will be increased production of nitric oxide. This nitric oxide when blown out will be found to be increased, and FeNO will be increased in bronchial asthma. This fractional excretion of nitric oxide means there is underlying inflammation. It also means there is an ineffective treatment with anti-inflammatory drugs. It also means the patient's compliance is poor with anti-inflammatory drugs. So FeNO is used in both diagnosis and prognostication. Coming now the last part, the management. Management of bronchial asthma can be divided into two parts, the controller medication and the reliever medication. So reliever means the bronchodilator, relief of symptoms, that is the reliever. Second one is the controller. Controller means it will control the inflammation, reduce the airway hyperresponsiveness, reduce the progression of disease. And this controller is what is the most important drugs. This is the anti-inflammatory drugs. So what are the bronchodilators we know? The bronchodilators, first one will be the beta agonist. This can be a short-acting beta agonist or a long-acting beta agonist. They act on their beta receptors, especially the beta 2 receptor, increase in cyclic AMP, increase in adenyl cyclase, increase in cyclic AMP, causing smooth muscle relaxation and bronchodilation. First one, they will inhibit the other bronchoconstrictor agents will be reduced. Second, third one, there will be some amount of mast cell stabilization by short-acting beta agonist. Fourth, the sensitive nerve trigger will also be decreased by short-acting beta agonist. The drugs in this group are the salbutamol, the terbutalin, the long acting medication is salmeterol and formoterol. The very long 24 hours acting is the indacaterol. These are the beta agonists that is used. The problem with using only beta agonist is that this beta agonist can only relieve the symptoms, but it can worsen the underlying inflammation, because only symptomatic benefit alone, if a patient is using frequent beta blockers, say beta agonist 2 to 3 times a day for a long period of time, that means that patient is having a severe underlying inflammation which is not controlled. So short acting beta agonist or a long acting beta agonist must not be used alone. They can be used for emergency purpose, but never used alone. Should always be combined with an inhalation of corticosteroids. That is the dictum. The second group of drugs are the anti-muscarinic drugs. The anti-muscarinic drugs means of ipratropium, tiotropium and other anticholinergic drugs. They can dry up the secretion. They can have some amount of bronchodilatation. They are predominantly used in COPD, but they can also be tried in bronchial asthma. This is a problem with this drug is that they can cause dry eyes, dry mouth, constipation, urine retention. These are the adverse effects seen with antimuscarinic agents. They are the ipratropium and the tiotropium. The third group of bronchodilators are the theophylline. The theophylline, they inhibit the phosphodiesterase enzymes. They will be increasing the cyclic AMP, thereby increasing the vasodilatation, and so that will cause bronchodilatation. This is the first finding. They can also, at high doses, they can inhibit the adenosine receptors, which is problematic, because adenosine inhibition can cause cardiac arrhythmias, epileptic seizures, and also death. The other adverse effects are nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, these palpitation tremors. They are common with these theophylline groups. This theophylline, it is a narrow therapeutic index. You have to go for a dose monitoring. The levels less than 10 nanogram per ml are usually asymptomatic. They are not associated with toxic symptoms. 10 to 20 over is the usual therapeutic dose. So you should not use a 10 to 20 nanogram dose. If you go for a less than 10 nanogram dose, so you combine with other inhalation corticosteroids or other group of drugs. This is the theophylline. This has got high cytochrome interactions in the liver. Can cause increased risk of drug toxicity by other with other drug interactions. And the controllers, these are the drugs used in the treatment of bronchial asthma. First is the inhalation corticosteroids, fluticasone, mometasone, budesonide, inhalation budesonide, that is the most commonly used drugs. These are the drugs for the treatment of bronchial asthma, because they suppress the underlying inflammation. They reduce the risk of airway hyperresponsiveness, reduce the frequency of symptoms, reduce the progression of disease severity. They usually treat them within an acute phase. They use both acute as well as chronic. So inhalation corticosteroids should be given BD dose for a long period of time, because they can reduce the inflammatory cell, the neutrophil, eosinophil and mast cells within the bronchial wall, that will be decreased. Secondly, histone deacetylation there will be a decrease in the pro-inflammatory cytokines and an increase in the anti-inflammatory cytokines. The MAP proteins and other proteins will be increased. Oral corticosteroids. If there is no response to inhalation corticosteroids, you can try oral corticosteroids. Oral corticosteroids are usually prednisone or prednisolone. They can be pretty much used, or a dexamethasone or a methylprednisolone. Any oral corticosteroids can be used. The problem with oral corticosteroid is that they can have systemic adverse effect. Inhalation corticosteroids only cause any oral candidiasis or hoarseness of voice, or just these symptoms are seen with inhalation corticosteroids. Whereas in oral corticosteroids, they can develop systemic side effects of steroids, namely facial flushing, diabetes mellitus, hypertension, Cushing syndrome, abdominal distension, abdominal obesity, peripheral loss of peripheral muscle tissues, peripheral fat tissues, and cataract. These are seen with osteoporosis is very important side effect of systemic steroids. So any perimenopausal women should always be monitored for bone mineral density, because they are at high risk of developing osteoporosis. If they are having osteoporosis, treat the patient with some bisphosphonates or calcium supplementations. Oral corticosteroids, IV corticosteroids, and other group is mast cell stabilizers. These are the sodium nedoprolol and ketotifen. These group of drugs, they stabilize the mast cells, prevent their degranulation, reduce the number of mast cells in the epithelial layer. They can be used as an add-on therapy to single-agent corticosteroids. They are very effective in childhood bronchial asthma, but have been superseded by the inhalation and oral corticosteroids. Then other groups are the anti-IgE antibody. Anti-IgE antibodies is the omalizumab. This anti-IgE antibody reduces the circulating IgE as well as the IgE mediated effects are reduced by this omalizumab group of drugs. They are very costly drugs. They cannot be given in all the patients. They should be given only in selected patients who are not controlled with inhalation corticosteroids. These drugs should be given once in 3 weeks. Trial period can be given up to 4 months to see its efficacy. The other group of drugs are the anti-interleukin 5. They are the mepolizumab, the rezolizumab, and the benralizumab. These group of drugs, the anti-IL-5 drugs, they can reduce the eosinophil mediated allergic reactions. These are the common controller medications. The other therapeutic trials, the help of bronchial thermoplasty. Means endoscopically we go into the vessels, into the bronchioles, and we apply the heat by which we reduce the smooth muscle hypertrophy. This can be seen because the smooth muscles in bronchial asthma will be hypertrophied and there will be undergoes hyperplasia and there we have reduced beta responsiveness. So bronchial thermoplasty is also very effective. So how do you manage? Basically, plain management of short acting beta agonist is only SABA is contraindicated. Don't go for only SABA. If the patient is having an intermittent bronchial asthma, go for low dose ICS plus LABA. If the patient is having a mild persistent or an intermittent, if the patient is a moderate persistent, can have medium dose SABA, medium dose ICS plus LABA. The patient is having moderate persistent. The patient is severely persistent, then you can use LABA plus a high dose ICS. ICS means inhalation corticosteroids. You can try, if there is no response, you can try omalizumab or the leukotrienes. I forgot to mention about leukotrienes. Leukotrienes basically are released from the mast cell destabilization. These leukotrienes can cause bronchoconstriction, they can cause vasodilatation and increase the vascular exudation. This is by acting on the cis leukotriene receptors. This Montelukast zafirlukast will block the cis leukotriene receptors and will reduce the effect of leukotrienes. This group of drugs can be used as an add-on therapy to inhalation corticosteroids for a better symptom control. So the second group is Montelukast that can be added, or a theophylline group, the theophylline or a deriphylline. These group of drugs can also be tried. None of them responds. If the patient and if the every patient should be go for acute severe asthma. In acute severe asthma, the patient should be treated with NIV. Acute severe asthma. Acute severe asthma, NIV should be given a trial. If the patient desaturates or if there is loss of GCS or if the patient becomes SpO2 drops, GCS decreases, if the patient goes for skeletal muscle fatigue, then you have to go for intubate and mechanical ventilate. Okay, now just a small mention about special group of bronchial asthmas. First one is a brittle asthma. Brittle asthma, two types, type 1, type 2. Type 1 means the patient will have a chaotic variation in the, sometimes there will be high, sometimes will be low. There will be variation in the peak expected flow rate, and this should be managed with short acting beta agonist or a patient with inhalation corticosteroids. Second group of drugs have got a normal baseline with a sudden severe peak exacerbation causing life threatening bronchospasm. This should be managed with subcutaneous epinephrine. This is also called as brittle asthma. Second, asthma and pregnancy. 33% remain the same, 33% worsen, and 33% improve with pregnancy. don't go for all newer drugs. Go for all the traditional drugs like SABA or an ICS or a theophylline. These are time tested drugs and they should be given in pregnancy. Also prefer prednisone over prednisolone, because prednisolone does not cause fetal problems that can be read in pregnancy. Third one, a patient with a bronchial asthma who is a chronic smoker can develop asthma COPD overlap. Also, a COPD patient with an underlying eosinophilic inflammation of the airways can develop asthma COPD overlap. They can should be managed with a triple therapy: long acting beta agonist, long acting muscarinic agonist, and inhaled corticosteroids. This is the another. Third group will be steroid resistant bronchial asthma. Steroid resistant bronchial asthma means it is because of some genetic problems, the defective splicing of the GR beta mutation or interleukin 10 polymorphisms. These are the common causes of steroid resistant bronchial asthma, either complete or partial resistance. Thank you. And this sums up my discussion on bronchial asthma. I hope it was useful. Thank you.